There's a write-up in Gujarati where you can actually understand the discourse. And then there's a crude write-up in English. And then there's a much more polished write-up, all in Chanji's handwriting. So from the polished write-up, you can see some of the root words which Chanji wrote down in Gujarati. So here is what seems to me to be the obvious inference. The Chanji took down notes, maybe at the time, and maybe that night, he was a very industrious guy, went back to his room and, working from those notes, wrote up his recollection of what Baba said in Gujarati, because in this case it was easiest. And then going back to it, he wrote it up in a more developed and expressive form, and then he polished it a good bit. So who brought up the question about what Mayor Baba's words are? Somebody did earlier. This is the billion-dollar question. I guess nowadays we have to go to trillion-dollar for it to be worth anything. Pretty soon it'll have to be quadrillion, the quadrillion-dollar question. What are Mayor Baba's words? This is Baba's own secretary who was writing this stuff up, and there's clear evidence that he had in view its publication as a book. A K.J. Das store was going to do it, it looks like, and then K.J. Das store defected from Baba, and Baba was off to Europe, and the poor Indian Mandalay all got abandoned, so they filed the books away, and it never got done. But this was, what are Meher Baba's words? Well, Chanji, who was Baba's own secretary, was not hesitant to write up Baba's discourse with a view towards publishing it as a discourse in English. So are you going to say the question, are these Meher Baba's words? This is, see, the quadrillion-dollar question. Well, literally speaking, they're clearly not, right? And it may shock you all to hear it, but in point of fact, Meher Baba was silent, right? So he didn't give out any words at all. You know, maybe this would be a good time to, let me go to this. You know, hardly anybody ever commented on this. It's kind of an astonishing thing. But about how Baba's messages got composed. Where do I have this? Darn, I'm not remembering where it is. Shoot. No, I've gone past. Here, let me just try to see if I... This is a what Francis Brabazon... Yeah, here it is. Okay. You know Francis Brabazon, Baba's Australian disciple who lived with Baba from 1959 to 1969. Author of Stay With God and many other great works. When Stay With God was being prepared for publication, Baba gave him three messages from Baba to put in the book, right? And Francis was writing to Robert Rouse, who was another of Baba's close followers, who was living actually at the time at Avatar's abode. And he would talk on different topics. But here's what Francis said about how Baba would give a message. So now get this. He has given me some 6 pages of original material. I, of course, with the aid of, this little slash is Francis's symbol for the aid of Erich, had to work it out into English words. Erich and I spent 3 or 4 whole sessions with Baba on this, with me writing and rewriting and rewriting between sessions until Baba was completely satisfied. I have also been employed by Baba putting other material of his into English words. By the way, Francis played a huge role in The Everything and the Nothing. Are you acquainted with The Everything and the Nothing? Might be that. This experience has shown me how almost impossible it is, even with Erich interpreting Baba's gestures, and with Erich working with one, to get Baba's say down into English words. Writing down the words that Erich speaks from Baba's gestures does not get the real sense because, first, Erich is translating from a language, Baba's sign language. Isn't that magnificent? You've seen films. Well, it's so expressive. But how can you put it into words? Of course, you had a Mondali who would do so. But Baba's expression of it, let me just say, I remember when I was working on Infinite Intelligence, Balna too would chat from time to time. And he was trying to say, when Baba would express what came out as a word, it was infinitely expressive. And like he gave us the example, we were working with Infinite Intelligence, where the word infinite occurs about a million times, you know, and after a while, infinite, I know, infinite. Well, he was saying when Baba would gesture infinite, he would give this gesture, and it's like, oh my God, God is infinite. It's like, you have no idea, it's sort of like you'd get a glimpse of it, like that. So that was part of Baba's own language, you know. Even something that comes out as a very bland word, it's not bland at all when Baba was giving it. This is all in what we're talking about with Baba's words, right? So, which is complete in itself, right? You've seen films. There's a wholeness and fullness to when Baba gestures. And second, because Baba gradually develops his discourse over a series of sessions. During the first session, he only intimates his subject. So one has to try and grasp ideas clearly and then find English words to express them. I think that's a magnificent description of someone who is actually doing it. So I believe that all of Baba's words that we have, this kind of process came into play in the creation of them. So the real and true answer, this may sound like I'm being a total relativist on this, which I am not, okay? But the real answer is, well, what were Meher Baba's words? This is the real answer. You had to be there. But Meher Baba did pay attention to the rendering of his discourses into words and putting the seal of his publication on them. So we can't just, that was part of his work too. So I think the future will have to learn to engage the question of Meher Baba's words in a new way. For the last 2,500 years, it's been Holy Scripture, right? And that, I feel, was a development that God brought about, and it played a huge role. And I'm not knocking it one little bit. If you read like Shankaracharya or Ibn Arabi, or let's say St. Augustine, you know, these great saints, what magnificent things they did in the unfolding of Holy Scripture. But I think part of the work of Meher Baba's silence is that he's going to change all of that in a basic way. No way on earth I can cover this topic fully, but let's see, yeah. Right, that's exactly right, yeah. Oh, yeah. I'm not denying that at all. Totally. And like things like the discourses or God Speaks, Baba himself oversaw the process that led to its publication as a book. So you can't say these aren't Baba's words either. He put his name on the book saying, I am the author of this, right? I guess part of what I feel is we really need to take Baba's words as he gave them to us really seriously. And, you know, Baba would always say, literal, we can't dismiss that. But we have to find a way of engaging them more deeply. Not forget about the essence, the pith. I do believe that in the future, there will be readers, lovers of God, who will read Baba's books so deeply that in all essence, they'll get back to Baba dictating them. I think there will be people like that who will get the whole thing. The lovers of God will do that. Yeah.
Is there anyone who was with Baba when Baba was verbal and grew up
Yeah. Well, yeah, I mean, a lot of Baba's earliest disciples experienced that transition. But the lazy bums, they never did a write-up on the thing. There was one lazy bum, and that was Dr. Abdul Ghani. But Ramju was another one, and he was not a lazy bum one little bit. So, and many of the others, Adi K was there. You had people who weren't working in this line, like Padre and... You know, he was no dummy, so they could have settled, they experienced it, but we don't have real accounts from them on the matter, yeah. And then someone like Chanji met Baba while he was still speaking, but he didn't really come on board. Was it, Peter, remember, it was 1924, was he living with Baba yet? He met Baba 24. Which is January 25. So he might have had a little experience of Baba. Yeah. And of course, Baba's silence began on July 10th of that year. Yeah. So these guys knew it from experience. I find it to be most striking that this, they were well aware from right at the beginning of how the significance of what they, of who they were dealing with. Baba wasn't calling himself Avatar yet, but they, for all intents and purposes, knew it, you know. And Baba's silence was one of the most major and obvious parts of the deal. Yeah. Right. 26, yeah.
Yeah, there is
a little bit there. July 10th, 1926, there's an account of what is probably the dictation of infinite intelligence. Almost certainly it is that. So we have little hints. But like in working on creation and its causes, I may have said this last year, but I'm always so struck. Chanji's diaries for that period are very rich and very copious. Sometimes he'll have multiple diary entries for the same date. He's describing all sorts of things. Well, I don't know if any of you are working with students these days, like kids. Maybe let's go to some of the more rambunctious types, you know, who like to throw their teachers down flights of stairs and things like that. Can you imagine this situation? Meher Baba, it's nighttime, it's dark, 7:30, and there's no electricity, of course, and Baba is in seclusion. He comes to the window of what is now the samadhi, and he starts talking about prana and akash and the nothing and the everything. Not the topic that every 14-year-old boy would be interested in, right? And you've got, you know, Gujarati speakers, Marathi speakers, Persian speakers, Urdu speakers. And you've got to do translations into all those languages, right? Well, if you tried to do that in a lot of schools in America, the only question is how many people would be killed before the session is over. There'd be a riot, right? Well, none of these diaries even mention how this was done, because it was so, what I've inferred is it was so natural that it didn't occur to them to write about it, you know? I don't even know who did the translations or who took the... Wouldn't you think that that topic would come up? But it was so natural around Baba that nobody really thought about it very much, you know? I mean, being on silence like that, can you imagine if you tried to go and be on silence? So anyway, this is a big part. Yeah.
Well, I guess I'm
Right. 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 Yeah, I mean, Baba's way of communicating, it was really the live dictation was his medium. He did a little bit of writing. He wrote the book, but then he stopped writing. It was really, that was the medium. And Baba's, you know, divine knowledge, as you say, the person he's talking to, he would be one in consciousness with that person, actually. And what he would say would engage the person he's talking to their very depths of their being. And that's what Baba would do. And that is the source of all that we have as Baba's words. Now, some of these things Baba did dictate specifically with the purpose of having it written up and published. So let us not disparage that at all. Things like Discourses and God Speaks and other stuff like that. And I argue, even things like Infinite Intelligence and Tiffin Lectures, he had Chanji there writing it down. Baba knew that eventually this would be published. And I do feel the full force of Baba's avatar, but the atom bombs, as Erich told Don Stevens, they're there. I mean, my capacity to receive an atom bomb is sort of like a pop, a little pop. That's how much of it I can receive. But I will say that I've had a lot of pops. I believe in the atom bomb on the pop scale. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Right. Yeah, Chanji, 20 years, 1924 to 1944. Chanji was extraordinarily industrious. He must have worked all the time. Whereas Dr. Ghani was extraordinarily lazy. Oh, Baba loved it. Actually, his being lazy was part of his discipleship to Baba. That's really the truth. I probably told you this, but when I was just getting to know who the Mandali were in the 19th, do you know Dr. Ghani? Are you people acquainted? He's one of Baba's close Mandali. And brilliant. And very much central to Baba's discoursing, because Ghani would provoke Baba to talk on things, because Ghani was very interested in it and was quite knowledgeable about Sufism. But he was also world-class lazy, right? So I was getting to know this about him in the early 77, and so I went up and said, Erich, what was Dr. Ghani like? And Erich would look at you and know right where you were. He knew where I was with it, and he said, Dr. Ghani was the very living personification of everything that we weren't supposed to be. And then he told, because, you know, Erich was kind of on Chanji's side of this, of super, and then he told some of these hilarious stories about Ghani, you know, but then Erich said, all of this was on the surface. He was a priceless gem, you know. So that too is part of Baba's embrace, you know. All kinds of people. If you're on the Ghani, anyway, I won't tell. It's about somebody who's quite funny, actually. Yeah. But now, here's the thing about, this is all in Baba's words. And so this is a fundamental challenge to posterity about how to approach Baba's words. Because, you know, the idea of Holy Scripture is these, let's take the Quran, which was dictated to Muhammad by the Archangel Gabriel, you know, I believe it, and got written down quite early under the Mandali. They came up with it. I mean, you can raise questions about all of this, but it looks to me pretty darn good. So, I mean, a Muslim would be well, you could understand why they would say, these are the holy words of God. Every word is God's own speech to us. And I would say that's the dominant view within Islam, you know. And also it was never challenged by the greatest masters, like Ibn Arabi, perfect master, the supreme philosophic genius of Sufism. It never comes into question with him that these are the words of God. Even, it's more complicated, but with Shankaracharya, who was a perfect master and maybe even a minor incarnation of the Avatar, lived about the year 800 or so, he would take passages from the Upanishads. Now, anybody with some critical discrimination would say about some of these Upanishads, these are anecdotal write-ups of probably some perfect masters hundreds of years before. Obviously, you can't take these as literally what the person said. You know, it's much more remote than the Gospels are, for example. And yet, Shankaracharya, who was quite capable of raising this question, never doubted that every word was perfect, right? When, of course, you could ask that. So it wasn't the time for people to ask these questions. But I feel that part of the work of Baba's silence is that it is the time to ask these questions. And again, my feeling, I'll come to the other side of this now, is that we really do need to take the words as they were published seriously. And if you take those as the word of God, word for word, you'll be okay, you know. But part of the challenge is, it's not enough just to be literalistically, you know, splitting up words. We have to get back to the pith and the essence of it. We have to go into the depth of that. And I feel, of course, all throughout history, anybody with any spiritual development would have already known this. But now this challenge is being put to all of humanity. Our basic habits, take Baba's words really seriously, but you have to get to their depth. And that's part of what I think this work of Baba's silence is about. But now, as to what we do with the editing of Baba's words, this being my work, but it's my work, but I think it's a matter of concern to all of Baba's lovers. Because, you know, people will naturally say, well, you say these are Baba's words, but why should I believe that, right? And that's a very fair question. And Baba did make provision for this through his last will and testament. This is it. I might have shown this before. This is actually the document, what it looks like. 1959, Baba signed it, you see. Last will and testament of M.S. Irani, otherwise known as Meher Baba. And of its seven clauses, and the last clause is just a sign off, basically. Three of them have to do with copyrights. So you know what copyright is? The ownership of intellectual property. Now, there may be many who would say the Avatar's words belong to the universe, to the whole of humanity. Nobody can own them. It would be reasonable to think that, right? But Baba actually decided otherwise. And he actually made provision for the ownership of the intellectual property, most of which was to go to the Avatar Meher Baba Trust. And here he says, except for, and then he lists a bunch of books which he had given to Sufism Reoriented. I own copyrights in all my literary works, direct and indirect, published and unpublished, including. And notice the list here is not a list of titles, but a list of literary genres, right? Including sayings, poems, messages, articles, discourses, books, charts, maps, even maps, etc., as well as the copyrights already gifted to me and those that may be gifted to me in the future by other writers who love me, and hereinafter collectively called the copyrights. So Baba was giving the copyrights of all of that to the Avatar Mihir Baba Trust. So because of that, at the trust, I was one of the people involved in this, we felt it was a fundamental task entailed by copyright to come up with coherent policies on how Baba's words were to be edited. Now, this is a really important distinction, since this has been my main work for 25 years, a really important distinction that I make. You know, I was talking a minute ago where humanity will be challenged to read Baba's words, taking them as they come seriously, but fathoming, going into their depth, right? Well, I do not believe the people who edit Baba's words, you have to try to go into their depth, but you can't rewrite it on that basis, because that's for humanity to do. It is not for the editors, right? And so the actual text of it has to be taken seriously. And you can't just go revise, because then everybody will say, well, you say this is Baba's words, but it sounds like Ward Parks to me, you know, that asshole, I don't believe this one little bit. You know, it's a real question. You gotta have faith that the editors aren't doing that. This is not to deny that the greater challenge is to fathom those depths, but that is for humanity to do. It is not for the editors to rewrite on that basis. You get that distinction there? So, and the Baba world needs to have faith that what being given to them as Baba's words can be trusted essentially to be that. So here are some of the, here's another fundamental distinction that's part. So this is on Baba's words, right? You get how all this. And how Baba's lovers, I think it's really, have every right to know about this and have every right to challenge what they're getting. There's nothing wrong with that. If it's done honestly and without animosity, like you say that this is, you know, infinite intelligence, etc. Well, I think you totally messed up. There's no sin in raising such questions. You do have to do it honestly, you know, and be responsive. There has to be give and take here. But I feel that the participation of the community of Baba's lovers is really important in this. In a certain way, not a legal way, but in a deeper way, the community of Baba's lovers are the real guardians of his words. Legally, it's the Avatar Mihir Baba Trust, but in a deeper way, everyone has to be able to engage these questions for themselves. But here's Irma? That's for sure, yeah. That's part of what I think the work of Baba's silence is. Look, when you're reading this, you have to find me within yourself and deal with that. I don't know if you've got a nasty false ego, but I sure do. Deal with that problem, you know? And again, it's not like this is really new. All throughout history, great seekers have always done this. But what is new is a kind of a universalizing of this, you know, where the discourses, we have the discourses in like a whole bunch of different editions. Baba wanted Francis Babazon to do a whole new edition of God Speaks, for heaven's sakes. So part of that says, okay, Baba gave out these words to humanity and he put his name on it. That's no joke. His seal is on it. Don't dismiss them. But it's not enough just to read them in a superficial way. You have to really get into their depth. This is a challenge to all of his lovers. And it's not just, you know, the Al-Ghazalis or the Vivekanandas or the, you know, St. Augustines, who always did that. Everybody. Not everybody will do it, but Baba, I think this is part of the work of his silence, that we're being challenged to be deeper in our approach to his words. This is my opinion, anyway, for what it may be worth. But the trust made a fundamental distinction on editorial policy, and that is between what we call Baba's published words and Meher Baba's unpublished words. And these are the criteria. For Meher Baba's published words are books, messages, discourses that, three things, were published during Meher Baba's lifetime with Meher Baba's evident knowledge and approval and with his name on them as author. Those three, during his lifetime, with his evident knowledge and approval, with his name on them as author. Those count as Meher Baba's published words. And his unpublished words, I mean, we've published a lot of them now, don't satisfy all of those criteria. So for Meher Baba's published words, you know, all the books that people would know best, like Discourses God Speaks, Beams, Life at Its Best, The Everything and the Nothing, you know, things like those books, and other shorter messages, the Final Declaration, The Highest of the High, etc. So all of those would count as Baba's published words. And his unpublished words are clearly being referred to here, where he says, I own copyrights to all my literary works, direct and indirect, published and unpublished. Copyright means authorship. Baba is saying, I am the author of this also, right? In law, copyright and authorship are inseparable, right? So Baba is actually indicating, I am the author of things that weren't published too. And as to direct and indirect, that dichotomy, we have to presume, since this is Baba's last will and testament, that he was meant these to be, it wasn't, you know, how Baba talked in his own language and in our language. Well, this has got to be at least partly in our language, or how do you deal, you know, probate a will, right? So direct and indirect, I mean, like an indirect would be something recorded in a diary that comes to us in that form. So to me, clear, I mean, it's not just me, to the whole trust committee dealing with this, infinite intelligence is a clear case. Tiffin lectures, creation and its causes. These come to us in recorded accounts. That would be indirect, right? So these are Baba's unpublished words. This is the fundamental, this distinction is basic in trust's editorial policy, right? For Baba's published words, basically, we leave them alone. Now, when I say basically, if there's a spelling mistake, there's one discourse where it's impossible with three S's. Well, do we have to go on reproducing it that way for 700 years? Or the table of the classification of the types of meditation on page 168. Well, the text got reflowed and it's now 184. So do we have to go on? I mean, it's common sense, right? Things like this. But part of the policy is that every editorial alteration, howsoever tiny, needs to be recorded and made publicly available. Because one thing people might say is, oh, well, you say you're doing that, but in point of fact, you're doing much more. Fair question. So we have a register of editorial alterations that are available in the book or on the website. So spelling mistakes or subject-verb agreement, you know, or things like that. Accidentals, I would say. That's the limit of editing that happens with Baba's published words. But now with Meher Baba's unpublished words, that's another case, because it's obvious that more had to be done and has to be done on them. I won't take the time now to show you some of the passages from the intelligence notebooks, as we call them, that are the basis for infinite intelligence. But if we spent an hour reading them, I think almost everybody would, except the most literalist diehards, would agree this has to be edited. It's written in a kind of a code, practically, like the infinite intelligence, as the infinite mind, i.e.'s, the infinite real I, i.e. such and such, and then parentheses, which is the such and such. And then there's another embedded clause, i.e. such and such. And you, when you get down half a page, you get a verb that goes with the subject. Nobody can read that, you know. And I feel it was written that way because they knew perfectly well that this would have to get reworked before it could be published. But whoever was doing it, very likely Chanji, was saying, I want this to be exact, the most exact rendering possible of what we heard from Baba as Francis was describing it. The content, and the content is, it really is exact. It's a very wonderful source in that way, you know. It's quite precise in all of those things. But you can't, and we have messages from Baba on this very thing about how to, I have a much bigger presentation here about how it should be edited. But let me, here are the three criteria that the Avatar Mayor Baba Trust has set up for critical editions. And that's where this term, the trust's policy is that Baba's words have to be available in critical editions. And critical editions have to satisfy these three criteria. First, they're based on an exhaustive study of all relevant sources, documentary and others. You can't just take some piece of paper you got somewhere and say, Mayor Baba's words. You have to do all the research and find out every source that could possibly pertain to this, right? And also, there might be non-documentary. There used to be more of them, but they, unfortunately, have mostly died off. I would talk to Marwan or Erich or people. That would be a non-documentary source. Or a tape of Erich or Mani, you know, giving talks on matters pertaining to this. Everything, actually. That's the first thing, the critical edition. All this work has to be done beforehand. And like I'm telling you, this is years and years of work. I'm a kind of a big critic of a lot of the books that come out. They weren't pretending to be critical editions. Two, editorial principles that are consistent and objective. You see, you can't have the editor just say, oh, I think it means this. No. You've got to have evidence. You've got to be able to really point to your sources and a clear case for it. Objective in that way. You can't have the subjectivity of the editor. Of course, it's impossible to do this perfectly. But if you're trying to do this, you can do a hell of a better job than if you're not trying to do this. And editorial practices attuned to the kind of editing Baba wanted. We have evidence on this, okay? And three, transparency in these matters through instruments of disclosure within the edition itself. That is, this has to be wide open for people to say, well, you say this is from Baba, okay, I want to check this out for myself. There's nothing wrong with doing that. So the first one, all relevant sources need to be located and studied. These include not only sources for the text itself, but relevant historical and biographical background material. Then, how to edit. Editorial principles need to be clear, consistent, and comparatively objective, so that if someone other than the editor looks at it, would say, yeah, that seems reasonable to me. It's not just a highly subjective opinion. Editorial practice needs to attune itself to the kind of editing Meher Baba wanted. This can be ascertained by by his comments on the subject. Baba made some comments on how to edit his words. And B, by the evidence of how he actually got his books edited during his lifetime. Like, here's an example. He wanted Francis Brabazon to do a new edition of God Speaks. But Baba never finished giving Francis the points he needed, and Francis never did it, as it turned out. But Francis did, in his own handwriting, do about 20 pages. And he wrote in a letter to Ivy Deuce of Sufism, who published the book, that Baba liked it. Okay, there's evidence on the kind of editing that Baba liked. Right, we can see. So things like that. It's not just completely arbitrary at all. And the third imperative, transparency in these matters through instruments of disclosure within the edition itself. Readers need a way of learning about textual sources and editorial practices so that they can assess for themselves the authenticity of the text. This can be compared to honest business practices that include making financial information public and conducting audits. So some of these editions, I dare say some of you will have noticed there are huge sections of endnotes and descriptions of the manuscript. And I know that's the first thing all of you read. But for the rare few who don't read it, totally fine. But the point is, if you want to say, well, you say that Baba said this, well, did he? Okay, well, here's the answer. Usually there'll be an endnote if it's a problem, and you can look at the endnote. For TIFFIN lectures, the endnotes are all online, and you can click on the sources and see them for yourself. And there are many other parts telling what the manuscript is, what's the reason to believe that Baba said this, who the person was who took it down, were they there, are they reliable, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Now, most people won't be interested in this, but some will. And there will be some who will go in depth and say, well, are these Baba's words? Well, this is the evidence we have. So as you can see, the editorial process is, in a certain way, literalistic in that we're trying to minimize editorial discretion, but to make the text readable and to provide full information about that. The fathoming of the depth of it is up to the people who read the book. Yeah. You know, I don't know enough about the subject, so I don't really know. You know, as to, like, with the Gospels, yeah, I don't know what was wrong with them. They didn't bring their, when Jesus gave the Sermon on the Mount, they didn't bring their tape recorder. So we just have limited sources about it all. No, these are huge. You'd know much more about this than me. Pertaining to, say, the Gospels or something, or Baba? Yeah, with Baba. Yeah, I know. The Asheville group is hoarding the book. Winnie! No, Winnie snitched it from me. When I was staying in her house, she snuck down and took the book. Yeah. Well, yeah, no, there is more material, and so that's part of the work we're doing. Like that one? Yeah. More and more archival material is being scanned. It's a big job to read it, you know. People with an interest in this, actually Cassandra and I are trying to set up a way for people to help with this work. Yeah. So we could come up with another manuscript of infinite intelligence that will change the picture completely, and then a new edition might need to be done. It's getting to where I have more confidence that we've got most of the really major things. But all you need to do, like here's an example a few years ago, Jean Gousseff, you know him, he's living in India, French guy, and he was working with the archivists and would take pictures of interesting looking items for us to look at in the publication branch, and he brought it and I said, this is Dr. Ghani's book. You know, in 1947, 48, 49, Baba was dictating to him and then after the new life, Baba started over and dictated God Speaks to Erich. So this is the original, the 10 States of God chapter is there, for example. Now that was a total unknown thing. So things do pop up. We'll just have to wait and see. There's a lot more work. You know, in terms of like archiving and publishing, there's really a lot to be done. It's not just preserving papers, that's essential. But there's the study of them, the assimilation of them, the correlation of them, all this kind of stuff. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, Tiffin lectures. Yeah, I was in the middle of editing the Tiffin lectures. The manuscript we had was a top sheet copy of Tiffin lectures that the trust had. But it had these editor torturing gaps, like it would say, and then there'd be a blank, you know, half a line, and it was clearly to be filled in with a Gujarati, which almost certainly Baba would have used those words, or else big blanks where there are supposed to be diagrams, right? And how can you know what the diagram would be? So I'd been tormented with this for 15 years. And I was over with the Chris and Christy Pearson. We were going through some of their stuff for another purpose completely. And by God, they had a carbon copy of the typed manuscript with all of the stuff filled in. So these things, so it's our primary source. They wouldn't fill it in on the top sheet copy. They didn't want to spoil it. But the carbon copy was much more valuable than the top sheet. So these things do pop up, and maybe more will. We'll have to see about Right. Right. That's what it looks like to me, too, yeah. Maybe we'll be proven wrong, but the likelihood is that we've got a pretty complete picture, is what I would say. Right. They would usually get published. There'll probably be stuff to get. There's a lot of stuff still needs to be published. But usually, Baba would return to the subject and give a full discourse on it, you know. So I think we have a fairly complete picture now. We'll see. We'll see. Maybe not. Maybe something new will pop up. But as to how to edit, okay, this Baba clearly understood and intended that the discourses he was giving should be edited. This was always done, and with this early stuff. So we have, this is actually from the combined diary that Peter was just referring to. 7th of August, 1927, I'll read this one. No, it is not advisable to send my notes and lectures for composition to anyone, that is to write them up into proper prose, who is away from me. The writer must be here in order to ensure correctness. For example, K.J. Dustor, he was the honestly feel there's nothing wrong with that. Okay, there's a little nutshell. Now I'll send just the topics in this seminar is so huge. I'll say this much then about the matter of the interrelation of the different spiritual traditions. Here is I have a whole weekend series on this very topic. Is this the right one or is this the wrong one? No, that's not here. Sorry. What do I have here? Okay. Let's get here's an image. This is the mastery and servitude symbol, versions of it, which has the symbol of the different religions. So Baba said, I've come to bring together the great religions of the world like beads on a string, right? You know that phrase. So that, I think, will be a guidance to our community of Meher Baba's lovers when the time comes. And for some people, the time may have come now for people who are interested in the subject. But this is a fundamental approach which I recommend myself in approaching any other great religion or great spiritual tradition. It's two steps. The first is to enter into the discourse, the understanding, the vision of that religion or spiritual tradition empathetically and to try to understand it on its own terms. That's the first thing. Because the different great spiritual traditions have different codes, you might say, different systems of, you know, understanding. Like if the Quran tells us that Jesus was not the son of God, how ridiculous to have the idea that God could have a son. What are you thinking of as a patriarch like Zeus or something? Well, that was part of the work of that advent, you know, was to bring into the comprehension of humanity that God is transcendent. God is not like a creature like that. So if you enter deep, I love the Quran myself, if you enter into it deeply enough, you get to see it on its own terms. Take the time to do that and to put aside judgments on it based, even if it contradicts what Baba said. As a first step, just, you know, put that aside for the time being. But then the second stage I also think is essential. That is, in the end, I'm a devotee of Avatar Meher Baba, and I accept his formulation of things. And I may find a way of comprehending how these different code systems can be reconciled. But in the end, it's Meher Baba's that I'm committed to. And I shouldn't be ashamed. If somebody says, is Muhammad the Avatar? My answer is yes. I mean, I might, you know, be a little tactful when talking to a Muslim with, you know, who would be offended. There's no need to offend people all the time. But yes, he was the avatar. Why? Because Meher Baba said so. And that's my commitment. And let's suppose someone was then to say, now wait a second, Ward. Muslims back at that time, or Christians back at the time, or Buddhists back in Buddhist time, had a certain understanding to which they were committed, and you are now saying that your understanding supersedes those. But theirs was a limited framework given within the context of that period of time by the avatar. Well, you're operating under another limited framework that is just going to change by the next advent just as much as these old ones were. And my answer to that would be, yes, that's true. But I am accepting this because Avatar Meher Baba has the divine gnosis and gave this as appropriate understanding for this time. I don't have that gnosis, so I'm accepting what he gave. And in 700 years, some people may come along and say, what fools those Baba lovers were. Good, because then he'll have come again. So that, I feel that fundamental approach of entering imaginatively and empathetically into the formulations of other traditions and other people in other ages and not getting, oh, he said this and Baba said that. Don't, just wait a minute and understand it in its own way, in its own terms. And through an in-depth engagement, a lot of these problems dissolve, you know, if you're not superficial about it, in the depth of it. I know I have to end, so I'll say this. Muhammad, you know, the Quran says, man cannot be God, right? The idea that the prophet could be an incarnation of God is the height of blasphemy, right? Well, as a Baba lover, I can say, in a way, that is true. Because anything that I can possibly conceive to be man is not God, right? Even if I were on the sixth plane and saw Muhammad that way, that still would not be God. So in that way, it's true. And that was the truth that maybe Muhammad's advent was trying to emphasize. So I really do feel that a first, and if we really enter in a loving and empathetic and deeply comprehensive way into the formulations of the past, it will help to create a feeling of beads on a string, because people from other traditions won't feel that they're being attacked so much. But that should not make, I'll say me, but shy about saying, bottom line is I accept what Avatar Meher Baba said, because that's my revelation and my truth. It's a limited truth, but that's all that I'm capable of. So if the question comes up, this is where I take my stand, because you have to take your stand somewhere. Okay, well, that's enough for this morning. So Jai Baba.